this is my country now, you know. I've been brought up into it. I know the ways of it, you know. So I think this is my country, and I've just built myself around this country. So, but still, people don't accept that. They won't accept it, you know.
I feel that I am, you know, British, English, whatever you want to call it. And when somebody says that I'm not because of the colour of my skin, it sort of turns me, you know, makes my insides come out.
I define someone who is British as being white, and with their native language is English.
The basic ingredients of a Briton are that they should be, I suppose, white, and that they should consider themselves British, and that they should speak in a British voice and in an accent which is British.
In these English streets, the tone of voice is unmistakably Liverpudlian or broad Brummy, the accent as British as you like. But that is only one of the conditions, after all. When you are up north or in the Midlands, you are struck not so much by their desire to be regarded English or British as by the reaction of their elders, who are shocked and horrified that their children should want to consider this. If the young ones express a feeling of identity with this country, then their own traditional influence would be weakened. They had done everything to create and sustain a harmonious, loyal, and stable family system. Now, if the young feel they're not even Indians or Pakistanis, they would be wanting to live alone. Next, they would be giving up their social and cultural customs, and, who knows, even religion. If all this is oppressive for the young Asian, the framework of British society which he is attracted to is even more forbidding.
We'd like to fit in, isn't that? We wouldn't. I mean, this is... if there's any place you can fit in, it'd be here. But the colour of our skin will stop us, always. There'll always be a point where somebody, you know, even if we've lived here, you know, until we're 90, where somebody will say, yeah, you black bastard. I mean, that will be it.
How do your parents see you?
Typical English girl.
And do you feel English?
Well, I feel England is my home, because I was born over here. I'm about feeling English, though.
Parvez Khan is one of the thousands of Asian students who walks a tightrope between home and England. Unlike those, his seniors, who have learned to walk delicately so as not to offend either, he still believes individualism matters.
Going back, I don't think it can be done, not for my generation, not for my friends. My parents and other people's parents, I suppose, came so they could go back. They only came for the money. Now, I don't see what I could go back to in my case. I've been brought up here. I came when I was one. I'm 17 now, and I am as English as you could expect to be. Some would even say a very westernized and very anti-Asian, but if I went back to Pakistan, where I come from, I would be expected to fit in with everybody else. I wouldn't be expected to be me. I'd be expected to be a group of people, and I just don't think I'd fit in anymore.
I think I have adapted myself to the British way of life, but at the cost of something else.
At the cost of what?
Well, I feel I had to give certain things up in order to become British. I'm not as acceptable as I was, or as I would have been, if I hadn't adapted to the British way of life and the way I have.
Does it worry you?
No, it doesn't. Because what I feel what I've gained makes up for what I've lost.
Do your own people consider you to be an oddity?
Yes, I am considered an oddity because, you know, some of my relatives and friends don't understand why I'm living in my own house, on my own, all alone, without my parents. And I even haven't got married. and we're living a very westernized life.
The initiation into the British way of life means that the young Asian gives up loitering on street corners in a group. Sometimes he may come to a disco, hoping to beat Travolta at his own game. He no longer sits with his chums in pubs and tea shops to discuss the merits of last week's Indian movie. For most of them, it is the beginning of a painful conflict with their parents, which is also the beginning of their loneliness.
My parents think I should stay in the house, you know, do the housework and not go out. I don't think my parents would ever understand if I just, you know, I told them I wanted to go out with a boy. I would like to get married to him.
When you live in this country, you see, you know, say that when you're 16, 17, you like to go out, have a good time, you know, so you fall into the society, in other words. But your mother, knowing that she's the first generation, which we know, but she doesn't realise that what sort of life do we want.
Ajay bhi, jadon ke specially 15, 16 saal de ladke ladkiyan, zara sara unhon nu koi mare chidke, fat police ch chale jande ne, social worker nu khabar kar dene, wo police de jandi hai. So ede vaste samjho bada problem ho janda parents vaste. Eda matlab hai oh kuch keh nahi sakde unhon.
I left home when I was 14 because of trouble with my parents. Well, it started one night when I came in around about 9 o'clock and everybody was in the front room talking and my brother-in-law started arguing with me and I started arguing back and it all suddenly hit me. And then my sister started hitting me and I just got my coat and I walked out the house.
Hum zyada log ghair talim yafta hain, anpadh kisam ke hain. और उनकी मेजॉरिटी होने की वजह से हम अपने उन वालदैन को पूरी समझ नहीं थी कि हम बच्चों से किस तरह ट्रीट करें इस मुल्क में आकर तो उसकी वजह से ये हो गया कि मेजॉरिटी हमारे बच्चे जो है वो उनकी ये हालत है कि धोबी का कुत्ता न घर का न गाटता ना हमारे अनपढ़ वालदैन बच्चों को सही समझा सके यहाँ के माहौल के मुतलिक और अपने कल्चर के मुतलिक सही तालीम दे सके और ना बच्चों को कुछ मालूम है तो वो गुम हो गए हैं दे हैव बीन लास्ट
And I was feeling tired, so I went in one of these broken houses and stayed there for about 2 days, just staying in the house, not even going out. Well, after about 2 days being in the house, you know, I thought I couldn't stay there and I wanted to go home, so I went back home. And, you know, the police were at my house as well and they wanted to know where I stayed. So I told them and at first they wouldn't believe me. But afterwards they started, you know, said show us the house, so I showed them the house where I stayed. And then I went back home and, you know, my parents were all right. And then, you know, I just started getting, you know, restless at home.
लेकिन बाद ऐसी वाली हैं जिनको यहाँ के बच्चे जिनको हमने यहाँ पाला है वो नहीं समझ सकते तो हम तो समझते हैं कि जो इनको कह रहे हैं वो बिल्कुल सही है अपने मुल्क के हिसाब से और इनको चूंकि समझ नहीं आती तो वो मानते नहीं हैं यहाँ की तालीम ऐसी है तो जिस बच्चे हमसे बहस करना शुरू कर देते हैं तो हमें चुभती है लेकिन बाज़ हदूद ऐसी भी हैं जिसमें हमारे बच्चे चूंकि यहाँ पले हैं उस वैल्यू को नहीं समझ सकते तो वो उस पर बहस करके मानना नहीं चाहते जिससे हमें बड़ा दुख होता है
नहीं और... बात यह है कि हम मानना चाहते हैं वी वॉन्ट टू बिलीव वट यू से टू अस बट द थिंग इज दैट यू आर नॉट रियली प्रिपेयर टू डिस्कस थिंग्स फुली You know, rather than saying, right, you must do this and you must do that, you know, we want to do what you want us to do, you know, but you must discuss with us. See, we want to see what is right and what is wrong, and you must justify that by discussion.
Their ideas, their thinking belongs to Asia, in my opinion. And they still think as if they are back in India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, wherever. They still behave, the minds are still working in that way.
Do you find it difficult to express yourself in the presence of your father?
That's right, yes. He would mind, actually.
I don't blame him really, because that's the way he's been brought up, that's our culture and the background we come from, you know. I don't blame him. That's the way he is. We can't change him.
A few months back when a National Front meeting was held in Birmingham, the case was that I went into a restaurant, an Asian restaurant, and there were some men discussing Pakistani politics, because that's what Asian men do, discuss politics from back home. And somebody came in and said, the National Front are having a meeting. Have you heard? And somebody said, that's got nothing to do with us. And and it sort of makes you think. I mean, they're only here for a short period of time, but even the period of time they're here for, they're not worried. It's got nothing to do with them. It's a different world.
কারণ parents বলছে, parents বোন করছে অনেক আগে, parents বলছে বাচ্চাদের যদি proper parents হয়, যদি মানে মাথা খারাপ আর পাগল parents হলে তো চলবে না। অনেক parents আছে কাজ কি করে, কাজ করার সময় তাদের মাইন্ড থাকে না একরকম। কিন্তু আমি মনে করি আমার বাচ্চাদের আমি সব সময় ওদের ভালো মন্দ আমি সব সময় চিন্তা করি ওদের ভালোটা। তা আমি মনে করি যে এইটা parents ভালো বোঝে। And it's marriage stay better.
कई दफा ते माँ पियो बहुत ज्यादा कहते हैं जी ये उन्हें पियो ने अपनी तीन वर्ड छुट्टे थी
देखो जी वो दे तुसी अगर इमोशनल देखो ना हरकत वो दे ले तो उन्हें बिल्कुल ठीक है तो उन्हें क्या कि अगर मैं देखो मैं इन्हें नू इथे ले आंदा इन्हें नू मैं इथे अच्छा खाना खिलाया अच्छे कपड़े पाए अच्छे बेहतर कार से रखिया बेहतर हिंदुस्तान वालों इथे आराम नाल उन्होंने रखिया इसलिए जवान हुई ने तो इसलिए एक भी टुर गई तो एकदा तो भला इंसान सबर करता है चलो टुर गई दूजी भी वो त्रीजी भी तैयार होने की अभी मैं इसे वास्ते आया
Whenever one hears about Asians, young Asians, it always seems to be the girls who get into to the news, you know, whether it's newspapers, TV, or whatever media. And even on the Asian programs and magazine programs, it's always the Asian girls who receive the attention that some girl's been locked in and not allowed to go out at night and she's been beaten and such like. It never seems to be the boys. They never seem to have any problems as far as you know, the media is concerned. As they consider them as boys, they have a lot of freedom and they can do what they like. But I think that's wrong because basically the same rules apply to the boys as to the girls in an Asian household.
By and large, Asian boys are not as restricted at home as the girls are. Perhaps because of that, the young men have shown a greater desire to adopt Western values. They can only do this by giving up their religious and cultural heritage. But then, are they compensated by the British society with social acceptance or equal opportunities? Cut off from their own roots, rejected by the white West, they find they can return to their fold only after repentance. Some of them now cling to pastimes like kabaddi, a kind of rugby without a ball, and the bhangra dance. Most of these men have probably never visited a village in India or Pakistan. The Bhangra, a robust dance in the village square, looks like a fancy dress event in an English school hall. But for them, the hostile outside world has generated a kind of self-protection, which now extends to all aspects of living in England. They willingly maintain sexual segregation. They have once again accepted continuity of tradition. The elders know better.
ਬੱਚੇ ਮੇਰੇ ਖਿਆਲ ਨਾਲ ਵਿਆਹ ਕਰਨਗੇ
ਆਪਣੀ ਮਰਜ਼ੀ ਨਾਲ ਨਹੀਂ
ਕਰਨਗੇ ਆਪਣੀ ਮਰਜ਼ੀ ਨਾਲ ਨਹੀਂ ਕਰਨਗੇ
ਤਾਂ ਜੇ ਕਿਸੇ ਨੇ ਕਰ ਲਿਆ ਤੇ
ਫਿਰ ਕਰ ਲਿਆ ਤਾਂ ਉਸ ਵਾਸਤੇ ਇੱਕ ਸਜ਼ਾ ਕਿ ਫਿਰ ਆਪੇ ਉਸ ਚੀਜ਼ ਨੂੰ ਤੋੜ ਚਾੜੇਗਾ ਮੈਂ ਉਸ ਨੂੰ ਕੋਈ ਹੈਲਪ ਨਹੀਂ ਕਰਨੀ
ਮਤਲਬ ਤੁਸੀਂ ਕਹਿ ਰਹੇ ਹੋ ਕਿ ਮੇਰੇ ਇੱਥੇ ਨਾ ਬਣੀ
ਫਿਰ ਮੇਰੇ ਘਰ ਨਹੀਂ ਆ ਸਕਣਾ
ਪਰ ਇੰਨੀ ਸਖਤੀ ਕਿਉਂ ਜੇ ਕਰੋਗੇ
ਉਹਦੇ ਚੋਂ ਸਖਤੀ ਇਸ ਵਾਸਤੇ ਕਰਨੀ ਹੈ ਕਿ ਬੱਚੇ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਨੂੰ ਇਹ ਛੋਟੀ ਉਮਰ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ کہ پیار نو سمجھدے نہیں اور اس صحیح لو نو سمجھدے نہیں
جتھوں تک لڑکیاں دا سوال ہے لڑکیاں نو تے تانوں پتہ ہی ہے کہ جس سے ساڈے موچ کی لڑکی جوان دی ماں پہ خود ہی شادی کر دے انہوں فکر ہوندی شادی کی وہی حالت ایتھے لیکن اگر لڑکیاں سمجھو نہ سنن یا بالکل کہن کہ بھی یہ تہاڈا طریقہ ہی غلط ہے اسی اس ملک دے پیدا پلے ہاں تے سانوں یہ چیزاں ہیں تکلیف دے نے بہت زیادہ تکلیف دے نے ہر مذہب واسطے
ارینج میرج جڑی ہوندی ہے او دوویں پارٹی دے فیملیز جڑی ہوندی ہیں او بھی رسپانسیبل ہوندے نے فار دی فیوچر کہ آیا لڑکے اور لڑکی دے درمیان انہاں دی زندگی خوشگوار رہ سکے گی اور والدین جڑے نو اپنا ایکسپیرینس جڑا ہے وہ استعمال کردے نے چونکہ لڑکا اور لڑکی وہ اجے بہت چھوٹی عمر دے ہوندے نے اور انہاں دے سامنے جڑے مسئلے پیش آنے والے وہ انہاں نو سمجھ نہیں سکدے نے اور صرف محبت اس جوش دے وچ وہ آ کے اپنے جذبات دا ہی صرف فالو کردے نے
مز اختر ان کی شادی جو ہوگی تو وہ آپ کریں گی یا اپنی مرضی سے
نہ ہم مائیں کریں گی جیسا میرا ڈیڈی میرا شادی کیا میرا جنریشن ٹو جنریشن ہم لوگ ایسا ہی گارجین نے کیا ہے مائیں بھی ایسا ہی کرے گی جی
The most exciting, the most wondrous occasion in the lives of the Asians is marriage. For marriage means shedding the drab everyday garb and putting on silks and fineries. It means listening to suggestive songs and making witticisms with sexual innuendos. The buying and collecting of trousseaus and gold is one practice which gives this occasion a bourgeois flavor. Marriage is looking at beautiful girls. Marriage is catching a glance from a handsome man. Marriage is making whispered comments about the bride's jewels or the groom's art. Marriage is eating and guzzling into a state of stupor. But marriage, above all, is a social relationship between two groups, two families, rather than two individuals. And it is so organized that the girl remains obedient and subjugated.
Oh, my God.
Her presence in England has enabled Gurbachan Kaur to live separately. She puts on a brave face, but she cannot help tears coming to her eyes when she hears the word marriage.
ਬਾਅਦ 'ਚ ਫਿਰ ਇਹੀ ਹੋ ਜਾਂਦਾ ਕਿ ਔਰਤ ਮੇਰੇ ਮਤਲਬ ਸ਼ਾਦੀ ਹੋ ਗਈ ਆ, ਇਹ ਹੁਣ ਮਜ਼ਬੂਰ ਹੋ ਗਈ ਆ, ਇਹ ਮਤਲਬ ਵੀ ਹੁਣ ਜਿੱਧਰ ਨੂੰ ਮੈਂ ਇਹਨੂੰ ਲਾਊਂਗਾ ਇਹ ਲੱਗ ਤਾਂ ਜਾਣਾ ਹੀ ਆ। ਔਰਤਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਘਰ ਲੈ ਆਉਣਾ, ਬਾਅਦ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਫਿਰ ਜਿੱਥੇ ਜੀ ਕਰਦਾ ਫਰੰਟੂ ਫਿਰਨਾ, ਜੀ ਕੀਤਾ ਘਰ ਆਉਣਾ, ਜੀ ਕੀਤਾ ਘਰ ਨਹੀਂ ਆਉਣਾ। ਔਰਤ ਨਹੀਂ ਥੋੜੂ ਉਹਨੂੰ ਛੱਡ ਜਾਣਾ, ਇਹ ਚੀਜ਼ ਆ ਵੀ ਔਰਤ ਮਜ਼ਬੂਰ ਹੁੰਦੀ ਆ, ਉਹਨੇ ਤਾਂ ਘਰ ਆਉਣਾ, ਆਪਣੇ ਆਦਮੀ ਦੀ ਵੇਟ ਕਰਨੀ, ਦੇਖਣਾ, ਸੋਚਣਾ, ਅਤੇ ਆਦਮੀ ਨੂੰ ਹੁੰਦਾ ਵੀ ਚੱਲ ਮੈਂ ਜਿੱਥੇ ਚਲੇ ਗਿਆ ਔਰਤ ਨੇ ਤਾਂ ਘਰ ਹੀ ਬੈਠੀ ਰਹਿਣਾ।
A popular Asian fallacy is that an arranged marriage is more successful than the Western style love marriage because there are more divorces in a love marriage. It's a comforting feeling. The Eastern style arranged marriage, the settlers contend, is not without consultation with the boy and the girl, who can refuse if they want to. True, the boy and the girl are shown photographs before they're married. Sometimes they're even introduced. But so far, the vast majority of boys and girls are merely allowed the dignity of pretending that they're marrying of their own free will. It is futile to debate which system is better. The fact is that once the wedding arrangements are set in motion, the die is cast. Some do think of breaking out of the enormous hold of their families, but forget about it, for it offers security. Only the very resolute break out, and even they can't sustain the break.
For myself, I've been brought up in England, and to me, a complete arranged marriage like my parents was just wouldn't do, because they'd never met each other, never seen each other. In the past, arranged marriages have worked, but I think coming to England, it doesn't make any difference whether it's an arranged marriage or one of your choice, because people's views are changing anyway. And I think if you want to adapt to here, you have to have a sort of a compromise, really.
My marriage was arranged, and I'm quite happy. I think if you have a choice, I mean, if the boy and girl can meet, get to know each other, and they decide they want to get married, and the parents agree, then I don't see any, you know, reason why it shouldn't happen. If you're forced into it, obviously, I wouldn't be very happy about that.
Actually, I sacrificed my career for the sake of my family. I would have liked to have gone on to study further, you know, but because of my family commitments, I decided to give up my career. In other words, I left college, etc., and the commitment was that I was getting to get married. And in fact, it was my mother's decision that I should get married, so I did.
I went for holidays, and I was told that I'm going for holidays, and arrived there, and my father said, "You are getting married." Well, I did want to refuse, but I just couldn't, just the pressure and all the responsibilities that were on me. I just couldn't. Besides that, there was no time. There were only 2 days, and after traveling 12 hours in an aeroplane, it's very tiring. And I was very young when I came here, and it takes a long time to mix in that society. And I wasn't given any time to sort of think or talk to anybody or to mix in there at all.
In my opinion, until the first generation Asians, until, well, to put it bluntly, until they die out, there is no chance. Because my generation won't have a chance while they're still around.
Asian kids have got similar problems like mine, and I think a good solution would be for all of them to run away from home and their parents will realise that they want their independence.
Oh, I thought of that quite a few times, but I, you know, just to get away from everything, to be free and do whatever I want to, I don't get a chance. You know, I just can't. After sacrificing my ambitions and doing everything, I think it's not worth leaving the family now. I think it's too late.
Well, you can see the third and concluding part of this fascinating documentary portrait at 7:30 next Tuesday. They are to be found everywhere. The worst accommodation is good enough for them. Such folk do not need high wages. The slums of all the big towns swarm with them. They have brought with them filth and intemperance. Dirty habits which have become second nature to them do no great harm in the countryside where the population is scattered. On the other hand, the dangerous situation which develops when such habits are practiced among the crowded population of big cities must arouse feelings of apprehension and disgust. These words were written over 100 years ago by Engels, Karl Marx's close associate. And he was talking about the Irish. Countries, their peoples, communities need new minorities to be used as scapegoats. 100 years ago, it was the Irish. Before them, the Jews. After them, the Jews. And now, the new settlers, the Asians. Ironically enough, the Minskis have become Alis. Katz has given way to Khan. But does anything really change? I have been in this country a long time now. There are many like myself who've been here even longer. How do they look upon their presence in this country? One thing I know, none of the working class settlers who came to England 20 or 30 years ago want to die in this country. Age, the immigrants' disease, gives them a remoteness. They cherish the hope that one day they will be able to go back to their villages. Some of the English, too, hope that one fine morning they will wake up to find them all gone. It's the same Chekhovian dream. They are here. Here today, here tomorrow.
Have you been to the Midlands?
There's hundreds round here, isn't there? All the Indians there, I felt like a spot on a domino when I went there. Manchester's as bad. You had to wait for it to snow in Moss Side before they could count the population. Hey, you've got none in, have we? You can't be too careful. These hundreds, if they all left the Midlands, they'd have another 4 hours daylight there.
Eh, jehdi galat fehmi piche rahi si, is mulk de vich, labour movement de vich vi, ਕਿ ਜੇ ਨਸਲੀ ਵਿਤਕਰਾ ਹੈ ਤਾਂ ਉਹਦੇ ਅੱਗੇ ਚੁੱਪ ਕਰ ਜਾਣਾ ਚਾਹੀਦਾ ਉਹਦਾ ਜਵਾਬ ਨਹੀਂ ਦੇਣਾ ਚਾਹੀਦਾ ਕਿਉਂਕਿ ਉਹਦੇ ਨਾਲ ਗੱਲ ਜਿਹੜੀ ਹੈ ਉਹ ਹੋਰ ਵਿਗੜਦੀ ਹੈ
I think racism is a very important part of our national makeup and I think it's a fact that we must recognize we have to recognize in actual fact if we're going to make any inroads in towards eliminating racism
ਜਿਹੜੀ ਬਹੁਤ ਨਫ਼ਰਤ ਕਰਦੇ ਬਹੁਤ ਹੀ ਯਾਨੀ ਇਸ ਨੂੰ ਗੰਦਾ ਸਮਝਦੇ ਯਾਨੀ ਅਸੀਂ ਉਹ ਲੋਕ ਆ ਕਿ ਇਹਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਇਮਦਾਦ ਯਾਨੀ ਲੜਾਈ ਨੇ ਜ਼ਮਾਨੇ ਦੀ ਇਸ ਕਦਰ ਜ਼ਰੂਰ ਸੀ ਕਿ ਹਰ ਆਦਮੀ ਨੂੰ ਜੀ ਜੀ ਕਰਦੇ ਸਨ ਔਰ ਇਸ ਵਕਤ ਇਹ ਅਸਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਇਸ ਕਦਰ ਯਾਨੀ ਗੰਦਾ ਕਿਸਮ ਨਾਲ ਸਮਝਦੇ ਹਨ ਕਿ ਅਸਾਂ ਖੁਦ ਹੀ ਆਖਰ ਇਨਸਾਨ ਹਾਂ ਇਹ ਵੀ ਇਨਸਾਨ ਨਾ ਵਾਈਟ ਔਰ ਬਲੈਕ ਨਾ ਯਾਨੀ ਸਵਾਲ ਹੈ ਲੇਕਿਨ ਆਖਰ ਇਨਸਾਨ ਤਾਂ ਹੈ ਨਾ ਅਸੀਂ
ਇਫ ਅਸ ਇੰਗਲਿਸ਼ ਵੈਂਟ ਟੂ ਦੇ ਕੰਟਰੀ ਵਿਲ ਦੇ ਦੇ ਫੋਰਨਰਸ ਦੈਟ ਵਾਂਟ ਅਸ ਟੂ ਅਡੈਪਟ ਟੂ ਟੂ ਦੇ ਸਟੈਂਡਰਡ ਆਫ ਲਿਵਿੰਗ ਬਟ ਓਵਰ ਹੇਅਰ ਦੇ We don't want them to adapt to us, but we want them, but they won't accept it, you know what I mean?
The extremists in England are only too keen to express their views on television, not only with a smile, but a dagger, if possible. This gentleman is not an extremist, but like many good-hearted English souls, suffers from a racial blockage which makes it difficult for him to talk, except in the privacy of darkness.
They want us to adapt to them. Like, you know, the decimalisation. The money, all this come out because of them. To make it easier for them. See, they didn't want it the way we used to have it.
Now, of course, people will not admit to being racist, and again, the English least of all, because at the end of the day, no matter how reactionary the average Englishman may be, he would always want to give the appearance of being a liberal.
It is not as if all English people moving about are racist. If that was so, it would be such a simple problem to sort out. What actually is the problem is that it is rooted in the structures of society, where you can't see it, but where it is always apparent to people like me.
The danger is that the National Front, if you like, sets the tone, sets the argument for other people. But even more alarming is the threat to other people that is created by other institutions, institutions that we normally assume to be fairly neutral and a part of the English way of life. The police, the local authority, various departments within that, housing and education, social security, these whole sort of areas that make up our way of life, if you like, and are part of our government, seem to me, anyhow, to be discriminating against black and brown people in our society. And therefore, I would see them as being more of a racist threat than, say, an extremist group of people that walk the streets chanting slogans.
One of these Bangladeshi fellas, he went into one of these, you know, a corner shop, they said everything. He said, I want to buy some cat food. He said, you're not having any because you're eating it. He said, I'm not eating, I have a cat. He said, you go and bring your cat, mate. He said, you can have the cat food. 10 minutes later, he comes back with a cat under his arm. He says, all right, you beat me. There's your cat food. Following night, he's there again. I want some dog food. He said, you're not having any dog food because you said, you've got a cat. You're eating this, I know what you're doing. He said, I've got a dog. He said, you bring your dog, you can have the dog food. 10 minutes later, he's back with the dog under his arm. He says, right, there's the dog food. Following night, he comes in with a shoebox. He said, please to put your hand in the box. He puts his hand in. He said, thank you very much. Now, can I have some toilet rolls, please?
Stereotypes about Asian people, about black people, are almost invariably negative. It is about blacks committing crime, about blacks being on the dole queue, about blacks dirtying the streets, about blacks killing the chickens in their backyard, and so on. Images that are replete with ideas from the Raj, where the native was the half-devil, half-child of Kipling, where in fact he was the sort of person who could never be educated, of course was never civilized. And these perceptions have crept into the thinking, into present-day thinking of both the working classes and the middle classes.
I think it's quite significant that 20 years ago, people were saying that the maximum number of black people that the population of this country could tolerate and live harmoniously with was about 10%. Anything much more would be unacceptable. We now have a situation 20 years hence where we are saying that between 3 and 4% is too many. And I think that is how far we have come backwards.
Chaudhry Zaman Ali, one of the last remaining innocents, is a product of the Raj. Like many settlers who cannot read or write, he has remained true to the core of his culture. He was never really exposed to imperial designs or Whitehall values, and therefore never really opposed them. For him, there are only reminiscences.
Sunday, I asked Gandila, King na isna koi na dada moya na e apna joj to main sunday aaya to budh nu moya
e
koi kedi ajdi e koi e Elizabeth isna dada joj dila moya o main sunday aaya to wednesday moya sa budh nu moya tin dia te 40
45
saal ho gaye tanu ha 45 saal
ਮੇਰਾ ਮਤਲਬ ਹੈ ਹਕੂਮਤ ਨੇ ਬੰਦੇ ਪਬਲਿਕ ਨੇ ਬੰਦੇ ਇਸ ਕਦਰ ਸਨ ਕਿ ਪੁਲਿਸ ਤੱਕ ਮੈਂ ਆਇਆ ਤੇ ਇੱਕ ਦਫਾ ਭੁੱਲ ਗਿਆ ਤੇ ਇੱਕ ਬੁੱਢੀ ਔਰਤ ਨੇ ਮੇਰੇ ਕੋਲ ਪੁੱਛਿਆ ਕਿ ਭਾਈ ਤੂੰ ਕਿੱਥੇ ਜਾਣਾ ਮੈਂ ਐਡਰੈਸ ਨਹੀਂ ਸੀ ਲੇਕਿਨ ਬਾਹਰ ਜ਼ਬਾਨੀ ਥੋੜਾ ਨਾਮ ਜਾਣਨਾ ਸਾ ਨਾਟਿਕਾ ਉੱਥੇ ਜ ਗਿਆ ਤੇ ਉਸਨੇ ਬਸ ਕੰਡਕਟਰ ਕੀ ਬੁਲਾਇਆ ਨਾ ਪਹਿਲੇ ਪੁਲਿਸ ਵਾਲੇ ਕੀ ਬੁਲਾਇਆ ਪੁਲਿਸ ਵਾਲੇ ਫਿਰ ਬਸ ਕੰਡਕਟਰ ਕੀ ਬੁਲਾਇਆ ਬਸ ਕੰਡਕਟਰ ਵਾਲੇ ਨੇ ਕਿਹਾ ਕਿ ਭਾਈ ਇਸਨੇ ਕਾਰ ਫਲਾਣਾ ਨੰਬਰ ਹੈ ਐਡ ਨਾਟਿਕਾ ਉੱਥੇ ਪਹੁੰਚਾਈ ਉਹ ਬਸ ਕੰਡਕਟਰ ਨੇ ਬਸ ਖਲਾਈ ਔਰ ਮੈਨੂੰ ਉੱਥੇ ਪਹੁੰਚਾਇਆ ਔਰ ਬੜੀ ਅੱਛੀ ਯਾਨੀ ਤਰੀਕੇ ਨਾਲ ਯਾਨੀ ਸਾਡੇ ਨਾਲ ਵਰਤਾਓ ਕਰਦੇ ਸੀ
ਉਹ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਪਹਿਲੇ ਅੰਗਰੇਜ਼ ਸੀ ਉਹ ਕਦੇ ਚਲੇ ਗਏ ਕੋਈ ਨਵੇਂ ਆਏ ਅੰਗਰੇਜ਼ ਹੁਣ ਫਰਕ ਤਾਂ ਹੈ ਹੀ ਹੈ ਉਹ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਅਗਲੇ ਸੁਣੋ ਕੋਈ ਚਲੇ ਗਏ ਕਿਧਰੇ ਹੁਣ ਤੇ ਨਵੇਂ ਹੀ ਆਏ ਕੋਈ
ਇਹਨਾਂ ਕਿੱਥੇ ਤੁਰ ਗਏ
ਕੀ ਪਤਾ ਕੋਈ ਪਤਾ ਨਹੀਂ ਨਾ ਕਿਤੇ ਚਲੇ ਗਏ ਪਰ ਹੁਣ ਆਏ ਇਹਨਾਂ 'ਚ ਤਾਂ ਫਰਕ ਹੀ ਪਿਆ
ਉਹ ਚੰਗੇ ਸਨ
ਸਾਰੇ ਆਦਮੀ ਨੂੰ ਚੰਗਾ ਸਮਝਦੇ ਸਨ ਤਾਂ ਹੁਣ ਕਿਤੇ ਚਲੇ ਹੀ ਗਏ ਇਹ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਨਵੇਂ ਆਏ ਇਹਨਾਂ 'ਚ ਫਰਕ ਹੈ
You walk around the streets and you see all these packies all over the place, just lying around the gutters, smoking pipes and all this lark.
A myth is hard to explode. Even their worst enemies admit that the Asians did not come to this country to sit on the dole. They were encouraged to come in the post-war years when industrial regions in the north and the Midlands needed a lot of cheap, unskilled labor, partly because the aspiring English workers moved out of the dreary foundry jobs. So they came, not just a few, but quite a few.
There's nothing extraordinary about thousands of people coming from a place like the Asian subcontinent to this country. One must realize inevitably that the whole experience of imperialism and colonialism had created very special links between people who lived in the colonial territories and those who lived in the mother country. These links were economic, political, and sometimes almost psychological links. So therefore, it was almost logical that when a recession took place in our home countries, India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, coupled with other factors like the partition, which unsettled people and made for greater social mobility and unrest, at the same time as demand for labor, particularly in the industrialized parts of the country, of England, there would be a movement from that area into, say, for instance, Birmingham, Bradford, Leeds, Manchester, and so on.
ਤੇਰਾ ਪੌਂਡ ਵਿੱਚ ਕੋਈ ਮਜ਼ਾ ਨਹੀਂ ਬਣਿਆ ਮੈਂ ਇੱਕ ਬੜੀ ਗੰਦੀ ਫੈਕਟਰੀ 'ਚ ਕੰਮ ਕਰ ਰਿਹਾ ਔਰ 19 pence ਪਰ ਆਵਰ ਮੈਨੂੰ ਮਿਲਦੇ ਔਰ ਜੋ ਕਿ ਹੁਣ ਦੇਖੋ ਹੈਲਥ ਵਾਲੇ ਅਗਰ ਦੇਖਣ ਤਾਂ ਉਹ ਯਾਨੀ ਹੋ ਸਕਣਾ ਜੁਰਮਾਨਾ ਕਰਨ ਲੇਕਿਨ ਬਹਰਹਾਲ ਕੋਈ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਦੀ ਇਮਤਿਆਜ਼ ਨਾ ਕੋਈ ਸਾਡੀ ਸੁਣਦਾ ਯਾਨੀ ਕੋਈ ਬਹਿਣ ਨਹੀਂ ਜਗ੍ਹਾ ਨਹੀਂ ਕੋਈ ਟਾਈਮ ਚਾਹਣਾ ਨਹੀਂ ਔਰ ਮੇਰਾ ਮਤਲਬ ਹੈ ਮੈਂ 9 ਘੰਟੇ ਕੰਮ ਕਰਦਾ 9 ਘੰਟੇ ਯਾਨੀ ਪੂਰਾ ਖਲਦਾ ਪੂਰਾ ਔਰ ਇਤਨੀ ਜਫਾਕਸ਼ੀ ਨਾ ਕਰ ਰਹੀਆਂ ਕਿ ਹੋ ਸਕਣਾ ਕਿ ਸਾਨੂੰ ਇਹ ਜਵਾਬ ਹਾਲਾਂਕਿ ਬੜੀ ਗੰਦੀ ਫੈਕਟਰੀ
ਪਹਿਲਾਂ ਮੈਂ ਬਿਲਡਿੰਗ ਵਰਕਰ ਸਾਂ ਬਿਲਡਿੰਗ 'ਚ ਜੀ ਆ ਤਾਂ ਉਸ ਤੋਂ ਬਾਅਦ ਮੈਂ ਛੱਡ ਕੇ ਤਾਂ ਫਿਰ ਥਾਮਸ ਹੈਡਸ ਐਂਡ ਸਟੋਕਸ 'ਚ ਕੰਮ ਕੀਤਾ ਸੀ ਤਾਂ ਉਸ ਤੋਂ ਬਾਅਦ ਮੈਂ ਸੋਚਿਆ ਵੀ ਇਹ ਨਹੀਂ ਜ਼ਰਾ ਆਦਮੀ ਤਰੱਕੀ ਕਰਨੀ ਚਾਹੀਦੀ ਹੈ ਇਸ ਵਾਸਤੇ ਮੈਂ ਉਹ ਛੱਡ ਕੇ ਇੱਕ ਛੋਟੀ ਜਿਹੀ ਦੁਕਾਨ ਬਣਾਈ ਸੀ ਰਾਤ ਦਿਨ ਮੈਂ ਉਸ ਤੋਂ ਉੱਤੇ ਬਹੁਤ ਮਿਹਨਤ ਕੀਤੀ ਹੈ ਔਰ ਉਸ ਮਿਹਨਤ ਤੋਂ ਬਾਅਦ ਫਿਰ ਮੈਂ ਇੱਕ ਦੁਕਾਨ ਲਈ ਉਸ ਤੋਂ ਬਾਅਦ ਦੂਸਰੀ ਲਈ ਫਿਰ ਇਹਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਫ੍ਰੀ ਹੋਲਡ ਕਰਾ ਕੇ ਇਹ ਸੁਪਰ ਮਾਰਕੀਟ ਬਣਾ ਦਿੱਤੀ
Mr. Rasool likes to think he has made it, but only at the expense of sacrificing every minute of his life. Others are still trying and hoping. The hope for a better future has already created a dent in the family setup. The Asian woman has now stepped out of her home. She has flaunted tradition. But such is the compulsion of economics that even the upholder of tradition, the man, looks sideways. As long as she returns from work to cook and sew and clean and mend and mind the children and still remain obedient to the man of the house. If they are going to work, they are going to have to live somewhere. Rather than pay the rent, the peasant turned worker Asian likes to buy his own house. I doubt if there's ever been a group of people more anxious to acquire property than the Indians and the Pakistanis. And I wonder if there's any aspect of their presence, other than their accent, of course, which initiates a greater number of jokes about them.
A manager in a local factory, to myself, one day was praising the Asian workers he had in his factory, saying how well they worked and what good workers they were, and he would always hire an Indian because he knew how well they were going to work. But then he was confronted with a problem where two doors away, a house was up for sale in his road, and there was the prospect of an Asian family moving in, and he was very strongly opposed to this, saying, of course, that he wasn't prejudiced, he wasn't racist, but one must realize that it may lower the value of his house, and of course, standards may change in the road. And his wife even came out with suggestions that they will be eating curry all hours of the night and the smell will be absolutely terrible. This again is a barometer, it's an indicator of the racism that pervades our society, even though we won't admit it ourselves. And on that question of the smell of curry, I mean, what could be worse than sort of the smell of fish and chips?
That was in Wolverhampton. There was an accident there last week. A bed collapsed and 25 were injured. This priest, and he's walking down the road, he sees a little girl playing with the clackers. He thought, what a lovely scene that, a little English girl playing with the clackers. Very nice. He gets a bit near, he can hear this little girl saying, all the packies have got the houses, all the packies have got the houses. He said, Mary, what's that you're saying there? All the packies have got the houses. Can't you do something from the Bible like your mummy used to do when she was skipping? Or granny used to do when she was playing ball, like Nebuchadnezzar, the king of the Jews, bought his wife. Or Jesus Christ was born in a stable, Jesus Christ. Something from the Bible. So she said, all right, Father. And as he walks away, she gets him going, Jesus Christ was born in a stable, Jesus Christ was born in a stable. Because all the packies have got the houses on.
Packies, in this instance, is not just those from Pakistan. It's the new euphemistic word for all of them. It's not just that all of them have all the houses, thus depriving the poor English from having a roof over their heads. The misconception is compounded. If they live in rented premises, they are considered to be living in subhuman conditions, 15 to a room. If they buy their own places, the assumption is that they will shatter the tone of the neighborhood and destroy the English way of life. One thing is certain. Even if the Asians were to dress perfectly and behave impeccably, they would still be picked on for their language.
The thing which irritates me most about the Asian people and attitudes is the way in which they will chunter on merrily in their own language in front of the house community, in front of the English people. Of course, they could be saying anything they want, and majority of the times, people will think that they're talking about them behind their back. It's a very ignorant thing to do.
I think we should learn Asian languages because, like, you could walk out into the street and a few Pakis could walk down and they could be talking about you and you couldn't prove it or nothing.
Anyway, a lot of sleep. Right?
No. Before the anonymous gentleman and his friends get down to learning Urdu or Gujarati or Bengali, the Asians have at least begun to make an effort towards learning English.
Our teeth, good, our teeth.
Until recently, Pakistani and Indian husbands and fathers disapproved of the idea of their wives and daughters attending classes in English because of their fear that their women would end up behaving like the white women, that is to say, somewhat lax in morals. Such fears still exist, and so a class like this one must never have a man in sight.
What about this poor lady here? She's sad. Why do you think she's sad, Nazim?
She's got headache.
She's got a headache. Yeah. Why has she got a headache?
Because she's tired.
She's got a headache. Maybe she needs to take a tablet.
And a cup of tea.
Yeah, she needs to have a sit down.
Asi inni koshish kiti hai, asi anpadh log se. Dehatan de log aaye hain jinna shehri zindagi the na waqfiyat si. ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੇ ਇਤਨੀ ਕੋਸ਼ਿਸ਼ ਕੀਤੀ ਹੈ ਕਿ ਅੰਗਰੇਜ਼ੀ ਜ਼ਬਾਨ ਜ਼ਿਆਦਾ ਨਹੀਂ ਚਲੋ ਥੋੜ੍ਹਾ ਰਾਬਤਾ ਕਾਇਮ ਕਰ ਸਕਦੇ ਨੇ ਆਦਮੀ ਦੇ ਨਾਲ ਮਕਾਨ ਦੇ 'ਚ ਰਹਿ ਕੇ ਇੱਥੇ ਦੇ ਮਾਹੌਲ ਦੇ 'ਚ ਆਪਣੇ ਆਪ ਨੂੰ ਅਪਣਾਇਆ ਕੁਛ ਨਾ
ਆਈ ਸਪੀਕ ਇੰਗਲਿਸ਼ ਐਜ਼ ਆਈ ਡੂ ਐਂਡ ਆਈ ਆਲਸੋ ਸਪੀਕ ਮਾਈ ਮਦਰ ਟੰਗ ਐਂਡ ਦੇਰ ਆਰ ਨਿਊਮਰਸ ਏਸ਼ੀਅਨਸ ਹੂ ਨਾਟ ਓਨਲੀ ਸਪੀਕ ਇੰਗਲਿਸ਼ ਫਲੂਐਂਟਲੀ ਪਰਹੈਪਸ ਵਿਦ ਐਨ ਐਕਸੈਂਟ ਬਟ ਦੇ ਆਲਸੋ ਸਪੀਕ ਵੇਰੀਅਸ ਏਸ਼ੀਅਨ ਲੈਂਗੁਏਜਸ ਬਟ ਇਟਸ ਨਾਟ ਵੈਰੀ ਆਫਨ ਦੈਟ ਪੀਪਲ ਵਿਲ ਸੇ ਓ ਯੂ ਆਰ ਅ ਬਾਈਲਿੰਗੁਅਲ ਔਰ ਅ ਟ੍ਰਾਈਲਿੰਗੁਅਲ But if a person speaks English and French, for instance, or Italian, they're looked on with awe and wonder.
If anybody said to me, you're just like one of us, oh, you speak good English, I would take it as a compliment because that would mean to me that I have managed to enter into the frameworks of the English way of life. I would take it as an insult because it would mean that I might be in the process of entering into that framework, losing my own framework.
ਮੱਝ ਜਾਂ ਮਸਲਾ ਜਿਸ ਤਰ੍ਹਾਂ ਆਪਣੇ ਲੈਂਗੁਏਜ ਦਾ ਹੈਗਾ ਆਪਣੀ ਜੋ ਪੰਜਾਬੀ ਜਾਂ ਹਿੰਦੀ ਜਾਂ ਉਰਦੂ ਜ਼ਬਾਨ ਜਿਹੜੀ ਵੀ ਹੈਗੀ ਆ ਇਹਨੂੰ ਅਸੀਂ ਰੱਖੀਏ ਤਾਂ ਅਸੀਂ ਉਹਦੇ ਨਾਲ ਰੱਖ ਸਕਦੇ ਹਾਂ ਅਦਰਵਾਈਜ਼ ਮਤਲਬ ਮੈਂ ਇਹ ਕਹੂੰਗਾ ਵੀ ਸਾਨੂੰ ਜੋ ਕੁਛ ਉੱਥੋਂ ਲੈ ਕੇ ਤੁਰਦੇ ਉਹ ਇੱਥੇ ਨਹੀਂ ਮਿਲਦਾ ਹੈਗਾ ਤਾਂ ਸਾਨੂੰ ਖੁਦ ਬਖੁਦ ਆਪਣੇ ਉਹ ਜੋ ਪਿਛੋਕੜ ਹੈ ਜਿੱਥੋਂ ਅਸੀਂ ਤੁਰਦੇ ਹਾਂ ਉੱਥੇ ਸਾਨੂੰ ਆਪਣੇ ਜਾਣਾ ਪੈਂਦਾ ਹੈਗਾ।
ਕਹਾਂ ਬੁੱਧ ਪ੍ਰਾਪਤ ਉੱਚ ਹਮਾਰੀ ਵਰਨ ਨਾ ਸਕੈ ਜੋ ਮਹਿਮਾ ਤਿਹਾਰੀ।
These activities, solemn to the believers, are often looked upon as strange and weird ceremonies confirming the popular myth that the Easterners are forever worshipping their gods and tending their rituals. I was told by the organizers of this Sikh temple that they had never allowed the inner sanctum to be filmed because they felt that their religious ceremonies would be mocked. Tolerance, I sometimes feel, is only a dream of the humanists.
I particularly find that people make no differentiation between the different kinds of cultural expressions that come from the Asian subcontinent. There are Hindus, Muslims and Sikhs in terms of religion. In terms of culture, there are Punjabis, Gujaratis and Bengalis. In terms of nationalities, there are Indians, Pakistanis and Bangladeshis. And of course, these differences are completely covered over by the expression when the Englishman says, "They all look the same to me."
Those who originated from the Indo-Pakistan subcontinent are now dubbed not as colored people or Wogs, but respectively as Asians. Interestingly enough, the few thousand Chinese who live in this country are hardly ever referred to as Asians. If England had had only Cypriot and Sicilian immigrants, would they have been called the Europeans, I wonder? The reasons for bestowing the term Asians onto Indians and Pakistanis are sometimes amusing. Well, one cannot distinguish an Indian from a Pakistani, can one? Those who wear the turban, the Singhs, they're different. They're Pakistanis, aren't they? They're not. Are you sure? Ah, well, that's what I mean. Better to call them Asians. No one is offended. Whenever there is talk of the so-called Asians, you can be sure of certain reactions. They keep coming in. They don't mix with us. They moan all the time. If they're not so happy, why don't they go back? Nobody asked them to come. The accusers do not wish to know that only the dependents of Asian settlers are now allowed to enter Britain, and that a few hundred who do manage to get past the immigration control are sometimes subjected to humiliations that would justify the attention of the Human Rights Commission. The question of mixing is highly debatable because the Asians say whenever they try, the English withdraw into their shell. But what about going back? Some of the settlers are baffled when they hear this. They say they have earned the right to stay. They are not the uninvited guests they are made out to be, and they have contributed faithfully to all that society and administration demanded of them. Others become philosophical when they're asked to go back.
ਅਸੀਂ ਆਪਣੇ ਮੁਲਕ ਨੂੰ ਛੋੜ ਚੁੱਕੇ ਹਾਂ ਔਰ ਇਸ ਮੁਲਕ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਅਸੀਂ ਹੁਣ ਇੱਥੇ ਰਹਿ ਰਹੇ ਹਾਂ ਲਗਾਤਾਰ ਔਰ ਅਸੀਂ ਉਧਰ ਵਾਸਤੇ ਵੀ ਹੁਣ ਫਿੱਟ ਨਹੀਂ ਰਹੇ ਕਿਉਂਕਿ ਸਾਡੀ ਜ਼ਿੰਦਗੀ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਡਿਊਲਿਜ਼ਮ ਆ ਗਿਆ ਨਾ ਰਹੇ ਇੱਧਰ ਕੇ ਨਾ ਰਹੇ ਉੱਧਰ ਕੇ
ਜੋ ਫਿਊਚਰ ਅਸੀਂ ਇਸ ਵੇਲੇ ਆਪਣੇ ਕੰਮਾਂ ਦੇ ਉੱਤੇ ਠੀਕ ਹੈ ਖੁਸ਼ ਹਾਂ ਕਾਹਦੇ ਖੁਸ਼ ਹਾਂ ਵੀ ਸਾਨੂੰ ਤਕਰੀਬਨ ਮੈਂ ਮਹਿਸੂਸ ਕਰਦਾ ਹੁੰਦਾ ਵੀ ਜਿੱਥੇ ਮੈਂ ਜਿੰਨੀ ਜਗ੍ਹਾ 'ਤੇ ਕੰਮ ਕੀਤਾ ਆਪਣੇ ਹੱਕ ਲਈ ਲੜ ਕੇ ਆਪਣੇ ਹੱਕ ਲੈ ਕੇ ਕੰਮ ਕੀਤਾ ਹੈਗਾ ਠੀਕ ਹੈ ਬੇਸ਼ੱਕ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਦੇ ਅੰਦਰੋਂ ਗੋਰੇ ਲੋਕ ਸਾਡੇ ਨਾਲ ਨਫ਼ਰਤ ਕਰਦੇ ਅੰਦਰੋਂ ਬੇਸ਼ੱਕ ਕਰੀ ਜਾਣ
ਉਸ ਤੋਂ ਬਾਅਦ ਇਹ ਯਾਨੀ ਖੁਦਾ ਬਿਹਤਰ ਜਾਣਦਾ ਕਿ ਬਈ ਇਹਨਾਂ ਨੇ ਦੈਨ ਕੀ ਪੈ ਗਿਆ ਬਈ ਬਲਾਕੀ ਬਲਾਕੀ ਔਰ ਖਾਸ ਕਰ ਪਾਕਿਸਤਾਨੀ ਪਾਕੀ ਫਕਨ ਪਾਕੀ ਜਿਹੜੀ ਤਾਂ ਸਾਡੀ ਫਸਟ ਜਨਰੇਸ਼ਨ ਇਸ ਮੁਲਕ 'ਚ ਆਈ ਹੈ ਮੈਂ ਇਹ ਜ਼ਰੂਰ ਦਾਅਵੇ ਨਾਲ ਕਹਾਂਗਾ ਕਿ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਦੇ 'ਚ ਕੋਈ ਐਸਾ ਸ਼ਖਸ ਨਹੀਂ ਜਿਸ ਨੂੰ ਪੀਸ ਆਫ ਮਾਇੰਡ ਮਿਲੇ
A vast majority of these Asians, coolies of the empire, came at a mature age from small villages, almost completely untouched by Western civilization. Before they came, they were familiar only with a farming life. They have never had any real context in which to view their predicament. They make up a little more than 1.5% of the British population. They have lived in the belief that existence is a cross to be borne for the sake of their children. Life, in any case, is ephemeral. Hereafter is what counts. They have clung on to a pitiless routine of work and overtime. But now, with all the swift changes around them, especially within their own children, they're almost dumb. Their faces convey nothing but bewilderment.
See a longer version of that program tomorrow evening at 10:30. Birth is a glorious Asian event. Birth means feasting and singing and weaving garlands. Birth is eating the sweetest of meats and spinning jokes and laughing and choosing absurd and pompous names for the child. The whole matter of pregnancy is one of celebration. The would-be born is showered with blessings and omens. The new mother has a sense of power and achievement. Here in this hospital, she lies silent, staring into vacancy. It's not just the cold and clinical atmosphere of a hospital that wipes the smile off a radiant, expectant mother. It is also a banishment into a different discipline. The older ones now accept giving birth in a hospital with silent resignation. But for young mothers, reaching a maternity home is the culmination of bizarre happenings that begins with arriving in a strange country with a strange language to a strange husband.
To a lot of young brides who do come here, things like hospitalization is so totally alien that they are frightened, and they feel that, you know, it's something that they'd like help with or some sort of emotional support. They don't have their own families, their own mothers or their own fathers to turn to at that time, and they seek help from a social worker or from a health visitor, whoever's there who's prepared to listen to them.
Okay, thank you. Down into the
Sometimes even the instructions are difficult to follow because they involve perhaps fairly complex ways of tying a simple nappy, perhaps, which you wouldn't have seen even in a village where a baby would be just wrapped in a piece of material or something like that. And finding that, you know, she has to conform to standards that she's not at all used to. They're at a loss in this country and they just do not understand what is going on around them. She has a health visitor who comes in and says, do this, do that, do the other, and questions her on every step, virtually. And she not being, again, able to communicate to the health visitor that, look, we don't do this in our country. Can't I do it my own way, something I'm used to?
India, I'm
Child in the manger becomes, for most of the Asian children, a quaint, unmentionable subject at home, for the parents do not understand the ritual of nativity. At home, there are no preparations, no celebrations for Christmas. If child admits to that in school, he's made to feel odd. Quickly then, Asian children begin to invent imaginary gifts they've been promised for Christmas.